And yeah, so my name is Wilson Mendes. I'm living in Australia for almost 4 years, and I'm originally from Brazil. So I'm trying to understand a few languages. So like, I'm gonna try to learn a little bit. So today I'll be talking about data-driven front-end. Novaya Navigatia, Jira. Is that correct? Okay. But I won't go that further, unfortunately. So I'll just move that to English. And yeah, let's have some fun. So today I'll be talking about the things that we did to improve the Jira navigation and how in the middle of the process we decrease the bundle, we improve performance, we make some mechanism to make able us to work with A/B testing and all the stuff. And yeah, first things first, that's me. Easy. And let's jump into the whole history about Jira itself. The year was 2002. And that was the first version of the landing page that we had with Jira, sharing a few of the products, Jira Service Desk, Jira Software, and so on and so forth. And the first concept was quite simple. It was a page with a menu that you can see with a yellow border, and the content, white. Easy peasy, right? Inside this blue content, you can see that you have some icons. You can interact with them. That's what we call global content. So as when you click, when you mouse over them, you can have some events triggered. And all the items in the menu. So like, at the end, it's a menu. So what's the deal on this? Okay, keep in mind that this was a code that we started in 2002. And the year right now is 2019. So let's get a quick overall how the navigation works. But before that, I just want to invite everyone just to take a deep breath. Trust me, you need that. You guys ready?
Ready.
Again, you guys ready?
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's start the game. So I'll try my best as I can, I'll try as fast as I can so we can go further. So that's the way that works. We have a component called navigation, which has global props. And these props can be pretty much everything. And outside of this, you can have events. So you can have on resize, on reflow, and so on and so forth. And you have drawers. So every time they're clicking an icon, you can trigger an event. So it can be pretty much anything, right? And inside of this, you have one thing called AK container nested, which has a stack. And I'm asking you guys, what's a stack? Because I have no idea. And yeah, it's a page. That's the white content. It has a navigation, which can be a skeleton or navigation. A navigation, so I mean a skeleton or navigation. A page which has a prop navigation, which can have a skeleton navigation. Can be anything. And inside of this, you have the grid, so you can have like proportions for your content, buttons, pages, cards, and so on and so forth. And you have grid columns, which is the page. You do all that code to have your page here. Makes all the sense. Right? Clear code, easy to understand, like drawers. For me, like drawers, I try to translate stuff from English to Portuguese and it doesn't make any sense at all. Drawers are like when you try to draw something, like a paper, try to draw a person, like what's drawer in the web? So yeah, first problem, how to solve the code problems. Every time that we look at the code, we have that feeling. As I explained to you guys, you can see that, and the code starts increasing, and because the whole teammates are so afraid to add something. You have this reaction when you had to refactor, or when you have to fix, or when we had to improve, add a new feature. That was something common, unfortunately. But more than this, code is easy, right? We can just sit down, look at the code, try to understand, seek for understand, and fix it. But how to solve the architectural problems? As example, because this code, again, was created in 2002 and was a kind of evolution of this, we were not covering those scenarios. Like right now, the front-end applications are covering client-side render and server-side render, for example, lazy configuration, and the dev loop was really painful. It was taking like seconds, almost, in some cases, minutes. And if it takes too long for you to write some code, it takes you even longer to deploy production. Right. And to drive those improvements, we need to start with something, some metric. In that case, we use one metric called updex. Who here knows what updex is? Yeah. So yeah, updex is, in general, barely speaking, it's a metric that can define how your users are happy with the performance of your application. Let me give you some real example. That's the math that we have around this. So you have the number of satisfied users, the number of users that are tolerating that. Let's say if your page are taking 3 seconds to load, and some users are okay if it takes 5 seconds. Those 5 seconds, those users who are taking 5 seconds will be the tolerating ones. You can divide them by two and get the total of samples. So like the total of tolerating and satisfied, put them together, and that's the number that we have on updex. One more time, let's see a real updex math. You have those numbers, and after this math, you have the number of 90. This is a range number from 0 to 100. So 90 is actually quite good. But, however, we had 60. Long journey, but the first thing, the first point was, we were aware of that. So as far as we are aware, we can work on this. And usually, unfortunately for the users, we got this page. The users were trying to use something Jira, like, oh, let me drag one issue to one column to another, and the page just crashes for no reason. And yeah, the feeling was pretty much this. You were there, you can see the page, but you're so scared that you just want to leave. To solve this problem, one approach that we got was to create a new package called Navigation Next. So we had the old one called Navigation, and we have the new one called Navigation Next. Why we didn't improve the old one and we create a new one instead? I'll go on that path. So yeah, for this one, we still have the same concepts. At the end, it's still a menu, so nothing changed, right? But for the dev experience, we have different stuff. And let me show you a really quick demo about it. Just checking here. Can everyone see this? Let me increase a little. Yeah, you folks in the back? Dwight, let me see if I can. Ah, okay. Let me play a little. And yeah, this is one website called. Yes! So yeah, this website called CodeSandbox.io. So long story short, we don't need IDEs, we don't need editors in our machines anymore. We are really productive with some of those. But if you wanted to play around with this, you can just go to CodeSandbox, add the package, and be happy. Those are the examples for our design system called AlaceKit. And that's Arial, that's open source. It's there for everyone. And you can just play with this. That's a new package that we call Navigation Next. And here's the way that we're using. So we can come here, go to a menu, check some sortable items, and can sort items. You can do your configuration. All this content is totally lazy loaded, so it's easy if you want to just play with that. And it's totally client side rendered and server side renderable, so it's quite good, right? So if you wanted to come here. And let's get one thing. For example, we have the fly out on hover, which I'll explain what it is, but it's pretty much when you come here and you close, and the mouse over, it will open for you. You don't need to click anything. That's like, it's experimental feature, and you can do this. So like, if you have, what that means exactly, if you have any issues, if any consumer around the world have any issues, they can just go to AlaceKit website, create example, and simulate the issue. so we can fix as fast as we can. Also, this is our documentation. That's our real and live documentation. Really good. And yeah, back to business. Right now we have those components. So the first one is called navigation provider, which wraps the whole app just to make sure that we have the proper props that we need. And we have the layout manager. So like when you click something inside the page, outside the page, when you have any shortcuts that you need to use in your Jira, you trigger this guy. And inside of this, you have the page content. And the page content has the content. Okay, now it's at least I can read that and I can understand what's going on. Page content has a page content. Okay, not that bad. But more than this, we got some orderings. We had smooth transitions via API. Like as I showed you guys, all these transitions, all these manipulations are like easy peasy for the user. We start to use Emotion as CSS and JS solution, which gives us a lot of benefits. We don't need to care about the critical path because Emotion already does this for us. That means that we don't need to load all the CSS generated by CSS and JS at that moment if you're doing something like server-side render. And we got some improvements by built-in. The components client-side and server-side compatible. So independently of the way that we want to use, like Jira is using server-side render and Confluence uses client-side render, up to them. And we can do progressive rollout, which makes things easier. So we can have the navigation, the old component, and the navigation next. Because they are different packages, we are able to do something like this. So we have async modules that you can load based on some feature flag. Let's say, if you wanted to do a progressive rollout, like I wanted to test the new navigation only for 10% of the users in US, only in 10% of users in Europe. And I want to get this data, get some feedback, and try to understand if these things are working as expected. So you can easily check if the feature flag is on. And if it is, use the new navigation. Otherwise, use the other one. Or more than this, if you have some internal logic, you can just create a new file and add the logic there. Even easier. And when you have a component, the component has this logic via states, for example, and you can check if we're using the new navigation, load it, the new navigation, otherwise load the old one. So the user won't be loading both navigations. So they won't be loading like tons of code, a lot of kilobytes. And thinking people like are not, they don't have like, it's not everyone, unfortunately, who has like proper connection. Like usually in the globe, we have like 3G and we need to think of those things. Just with this small step, we had like the global updex increase in more than 5%, more than 5 points, which is quite amazing, right? Love this gift. However, what if we miss something? Every time that we talk about migrations, every time that we talk about move to something new, we always need to keep in mind that we have risk. As example, how long take 2 seconds for you folks? Is that too much? Is that too low? Okay. That's what I want to hear. And more than this, those are the big guys, Google and Amazon. Their full page load is taking less than 2 seconds. And the new navigation, the first time that we had in production, it was taking 2 seconds only to be loaded and rendered. That means that for 2 seconds, the user was seeing this. Or better, because they think that was an issue, they were seeing this. How we can solve that? Oh yeah, so one proper solution for this was, okay, let's use async load for those components and also the content. So you have the menu, you have the page. As far as you solve those contents, give to the user. The user can manipulate them. The user can start to really use the page. As an example, to make this quick, we just changed the layout manager to async layout manager. makes some sense. Now I can read and I can still understand, right? And the way it was, the experience for the user was this. So we could use strings to load every piece of the website, which makes things easier. And every piece which already loaded is ready for the user. They don't need to wait for the whole page to be loaded. And as well as every component should be, we always need to think that they need to be plug and play. Like this, that's the best experience. I just wanna go there, use a component. I don't wanna know what's happening inside. I just wanna know that if I give these props, I'll receive this information. And that's all. Unfortunately, for sometimes you have this experience. You need to read the source code. Sometimes you don't have proper documentation. And yeah, it's not ideal. And we as developers, we always talk, read the manual. But yeah. So some concerns about it. We had to care about bundle size. Because navigation was used broadly across all the products, bundle size was a concern. And I mean like every single kilobyte matters. The time for the first render was really important. As an example that I show you folks, it was taking 2 seconds to load the page. So we need to care about those points. And as fast as we can, as much as we could, use prefetch and preload for our content. And to make this even better, let's use some data-driven approach, right? So we don't need to think that, maybe if I do this, I'll solve this problem. Maybe if I do that, I'll improve the code. No, show me some data before and after, and let's move on with this. Step one, let's talk about the bundle. When you see this page, again, quite simple, but they have one file called async navigation XJS. Only this file got 500 kilobytes gzipped. Gzipped, it's probably like 3 megabytes without gzip. It's a massive chunk of code. And how we can analyze and how we can decrease this bundle. First one, we can use different toolings to get more information. In this case, we use Webpack Bundle Analyzer. Even try to understand what was going on, what we can remove as code, and what we can import in a different way so we don't need to get all the content for that package, just what we need. And that was the piece after this small investigation. It took us 1 week or so, and we could decrease from 500 to 132. Other approach that we can use, and this is available for all of us, is about to bundle types. If you look for frameworks like Angular, Ember, or even React, they're using different bundle types so you can define in your application which one is the best for you. It's usually by definition they're exporting as CJS or CommonJS, but you can use, for example, ESM, which is the new module specification for JavaScript modules and Node modules. And the benefit of this is that totally tree shakeable. And tree shakeable, I mean, if you have 10 functions that just want to use one, I would just load that one, and that's all. And for example, a few approaches that we tried to use to decrease this idea. The first one that we got in a dev huddle was, let's think about package composition. So instead of have everything in the same package, let's split the navigation in different packages, and consumers like Jira and Confluence, Bitbucket, even Trello, they can connect themselves. They can do this composition on their end. But that's a main problem. That's a huge problem. First of all, we already had code production. That means that we had to roll back everything that we've done since we started with that journey. So we had a lot of change. We have a lot of risk in the consumers because we had to start from scratch. We probably can break stuff again, and nobody wants to see the website broken. And we need to restart rollout. Think how we can roll out, how we can validate. And to avoid this risk, to try to avoid these problems, we use something that's simple. It's called entry points. It's not relatively new. If you go to packages like Lodash, Date, FNS, and others, they already do this. It's pretty much, you go to the package slash the name of the function, and you can import only that function instead of import the whole package. And if you think that Lodash is almost 100 functions, I don't need all of them. I probably will need like 3 or 4 sometimes. So it's a good thing. So why not use in our navigation? And with that become another problem. How we can make these entry points, those entry points, totally agnostic. And agnostic, I mean, the consumer doesn't need to know how we organize this stuff in our end. They don't need to know that we have a folder called dist. They don't need to know that we have a folder called UMD. And if we change those folder names, they shouldn't break anything. Should be like smooth transition. As example, we have here the package folder structure, which has source, components, connected, navigation provider, and the root folder we have the index. Quite simple. It's like every package has something similar, different folder names, different file names. For now, it's okay. And the entry point will be one file in the root folder. However, and I'm loving this slide, however, is what if we change connected to provider? We are just breaking the whole thing. So we unfortunately found this in one of our dog food instances, which is a good thing. It's better than production. But the feeling for us was, okay, let's move on. Let's add these new features and let's get in the house. And this is happening. How can we fix this? Okay. The main problem for the whole thing, as we got here, is like, a priority should be simple. We don't need to think too much about how the users will see the internals. They don't need to know the internals, that case. And we can be all the devs can be able to play with this, can do any improvements with no risk. And the whole dev experience can be improved. For this, we use a Babel configuration at the first time. So every time that the users try to go to Alaskit navigation next, instead of go directly from there, they can configure to go to a ESM folder or CommonJS folder or any bundle type that you have. That's one way to go. After that, we realized that we could make it better. And we just created entry points. Entry points in that case as a folder. In the build time, the build process, we run a script. That script creates a folder in the root of your project. And that folder has only a package.json. And in this package.json, we have the name of the entry point, like in that case, navigation provider. It should be private, otherwise it will be published as another package. And it has all the files the way that you want to use. As you can see here, we have the main for the CommonJS, the module for ESM, and browser for UMD. And for the user, it's still the same way to go. For the user, nothing changes. All the improvements that we did in the middle of the journey was, first, setting performance budget. Performance budget is one approach that we can use to split your code in a better way for the consumers. Like when the user tries to go to one page, you don't need to load that the first time, only when he tries to go there. And even that page, you don't need to load the whole page itself. You can load bits and pieces and try to use the user interaction at the top. Async load components, always great. And another point we need to keep in mind that we need to work to improve the critical path management. Every time that the user loads the page, it loads a bunch of code, but not necessarily they need that code. So you can easily get this with like Chrome DevTools. Just run a small inspection and check it out, or even Lighthouse CI or Lighthouse, try to do on any addition locally and get which bits and pieces you need and which bits and pieces you can just postpone to load. And optimistic preloading, which is something quite interesting. When you go to the menu in Jira's example, nothing of that content exists at all. However, when you go to get your mouse and pass through one of the items, we already loaded the content in background. So when you click, the content is already there, which makes things easier and smooth. And let me show you one thing about entry points. Another live coding. Let's see how it goes. Regards to performance budget, we were using one thing that we called user time API. Who here knows what user time API is? Great. So yeah, user time API is a way that the browser already gives to you to add some marks. So you can pretty much add some instrumentation in any journey that you have in your page. Like when the user clicks the content is loaded. When the user tries to navigate to page A, to page B, and you can get those values, and you can keep tracking, keep monitoring those values, and keep improving. And as example, sure. Can everyone read that? Great. So yeah, this is a package, a small one called PerfMarks. PerfMarks is like a lightweight way to track performance based in user time API. So if you have the user time API in your browser, you can use it. Otherwise, it falls back to date.now, which still gives you some good values. The way to use is quite simple, and here's a way to go. And let me show you how you can measure those in a different tab. So if you come here, you have those values, right? Those values are related to different features. Let's think that every piece here, every one of these perf marks are related to one feature, like when the page is loaded, when the user is authenticated, how long it's taking to the user to send information to the API, come back and get notified that he's already logged. And can be anything. It's up to us to add the instrumentation. The way to get that is when you go to Performance tab in Chrome DevTools, you click to record, it will take a few seconds and start to process in profile. And at the end, you have this beautiful graph here. It has different things, as folks can see here. You can see the network, frames, interactions, the main thread, what's happening there. But the most important for us is this piece called timings. And here we have the timings that took our feature. And this is like 30K bytes, so you can use anywhere. And for PerfMarks, you can use something like this. So you don't need to load the whole package. You can load only one piece of what you want. In that case, you just need to add a mark. The way to use is quite straightforward. Use perfmarks dot. And when you want to finish the instrumentation, and perfmarks dot start with the name of the mark. Let's start, let's finish, let's get the data. You can send it to any platform that you want, like Google Analytics or any other that you want, and analyze those information later. But this is the beauty of that. And when you go what mark is, let me increase a little as well. Close that. Yeah. That's the way that we can create entry points. A package JSON with nothing more than the name of the entry point. Package name slash the file, and point to another file. Simple. So you don't need to load all those files if you don't want to. This is a small package, but think of this as a big application, big component. This can be like really useful for you. And yeah, back to business. All those combinations gives us the benefit of move from 132 to 10K. Quite impressive. Use this approach with no moderation in your apps, please. You see all the benefits on this. All the cool stuff. Webpack is like a great tooling for bundle when we talk about front end. Now we'll talk a little bit more about Postgres. They have different approaches, different philosophies, but both has the same idea of DLL. You create a file, instead of create them again, you just store a cache and keep reusing it. And for Devloop, that's really good because it took decreases from 30 seconds to 5 seconds to have a live reload. So we decrease the dev experience, the dev loop from 30 seconds to 5, 10 sometimes. Quite good. And the configuration is like just this. It's not that hard. It's easy to use right now if you want to. And now we decrease the main bundle for 300 KB to 30. 300 to 30. 500. Whoa. Yeah. Other point. Let's talk about A-B testing. A-B testing was something that is not new. If you look for big companies like Google or Booking, they are really, really familiar with the approach. It's pretty much when you try to validate one idea, one hypothesis, or some new feature, how you can do. Let's try to see, like, if you have a new payment provider, a new card that you need to put in your e-commerce, you can check, okay, let's see if this is working or not, and if you can move on to the next one. Let's see, if you want to move from MasterCard, you just, I don't want to deal with all those third parties, I just want to use a Stripe. Can be one way. Or you can change the whole user experience, which will be even better for this case. For a real example, we have the flyout that I showed you before. You can go to the menu. When you mouse over, it opens the menu, it loads the content asynchronously, and you can interact with the page. And we start to think on how to monitor those information, how to monitor the success of this feature. Or even if it fails, what we can do. So we can see, okay, the user didn't like that. We can remove after 3 months or after 2 months of validation. So the first part of this was we had the flyout that the users can just open the menu when the mouse over. You have the Optimist preloaded. So as soon as the user put the mouse at the top of the menu, you load that content. And you have A-B testing. So people from different regions across the world can see the new navigation with this feature and without this feature. We can get all this data, put them together, and analyze it. And we just got realized that we didn't have any standards to do A-B testing company-wise. Every team was doing this, but they have their own ways to do. Or it could be ifs in the code, could be something that just put them together in a single file, and they would never move out from that, even if the hypothesis was wrong. So let's start with a few definitions for this. I'll try to avoid this in the future steps. First, we added the experiment prefix for every single prop that we have for those new features, for those new experimentations, so we can track via code how we are doing and how many experiments we have. Keep in mind that we'll talk about one navigation, a small piece, but different teams across the world can do different experimentations. So you can go to a page and can have like 10 experimentations at the same time. And one experimentation can affect the other one. So you can track, you can create some standards for like those pages can have at maximum 5 experimentations. Otherwise, we are not validating anything. Always run those in a sync. So the user will be punished when try to load the new navigation with flyout, with new navigation without flyout, like we did with navigation and navigation X packages, but inside we just added new files. Why this? Because it's easy to add, and more than this, is easy to remove in case we need. So that's the experimental prefix. Simple, it's a new prop, experimental underscore at the front. That's the way that we added. And can be for any other new feature, any new other experimentation that we have. The way that we're loading async again, so you can get the component and pass the logic for the page. Otherwise, you can have, if something goes wrong with the async load, you can have some monitoring track on this. Like you can page someone and say, hey, there's something going on with the CDN in that region, and we need to work on this. And the good part about easy to remove is like, because we pretty much duplicated the file and they added the new content for the one with flyout and without flyout. If after 2 months we just got realized that, okay, that's the way that we want to go, we just need to queue a file. Queue a file, queue a feature flag, will be way easier than get a massive component with a lot of logic mixed to check when the user is doing this and when the user is doing that, when the user has this configuration, the other one. That was an approach that we used. Of course, there's a lot of different ones, but that's the one that we were using, we're still using, and we have some good stories about it. And how to analyze that? So every time that we have users using different values, different features, we can send this data for different fronts, different platforms, and you can analyze this in the future. That means that we can literally say for anyone that that feature is a success or the feature needs to be rethinked or just removed. Impacts, we can share experiment ownership for everyone. So my team, for example, I'm working a team called Media, which is responsible for all the experience about uploading, downloading, and everything that need to do with files across Atlassian. If someone wants to do any experimentation with my team, they are able to do this if they have all the context with less friction as possible. You have all the flexibility. So now we have the design system teams and the products doing all the experimentation, all the A/B testing, which we never did that before. So design system was a platform with all the main components, but they were not able to do any A/B testing, and now we are. So that means that we can all do any type of innovation that we want to. And more than this, we can experiment in all layers because we don't have any friction between those. That's massive. I know there's a lot of thing, there's a lot of content. So a quick recap at the end is like, first thing that we got from this talk is think in architecture. Second, think how you can enable experimentation if you want to, or if your company is keen to. And if you need to do something like this in the future, always keep in mind how to avoid any possible risk. Migration plans, risk management, what happens if something goes really wrong, which unfortunately can happen. Define the load solution when we talk about front end specifically. You want to go with client side, server side, a kind of both to make your app faster, up to the team. And yeah, again, minimize all the risks. And next steps for this are something that we still figure out, but we have a few ideas. One thing that we're doing right now actually is validating a new way to the users to find anything in Jira and Confluence and all the products that we are calling navigation next. And it's pretty much, if you look around and see, okay, you already moved to a new navigation, why are you doing this again? Actually, the whole journey, we got so much learn on this. We shared all these things with all the teams, so everyone is able to do experimentation. Let's see, maybe this is better than the current one. And we can validate that, and we have data for this, and we can make it easier right now. So let's see. The future for us right now is bright. We can do anything we want. It's still a long journey, but we have some good stuff to share. So yeah, спасибо.